serialization, deserialization. So serialization refers to having multiple streams at a particular data rate, and you combine all of them to, if you have n streams, at n times the original data rate. Okay. So you combine it to a single stream at n times fr bits per second. So to start with, let's just take two. I'll call it stream 0 and stream 1. And this is how they are available to you. Okay. And stream 1 is also at the same rate and is synchronized with stream 0. But let me not call these streams 0 and 1. I can call it, let's say, odd and. So these are bit transitions, right? So it can be, any bit can be either 0 or 1. We are talking about binary data. And this is the even stream and this is the odd stream. And what you want to get from this is a single stream and so on. Okay. So just basically you take one of this and the next one and the next one and so on. And of course, if this is some TS, what is this? TS by 2. Okay. So how do we do this? How can we do this? Ideas. Multiplexer that is clocked at twice the rate. Of twice the rate of what? So let's also assume that we have the clock associated with these two data streams. Okay. So I have also the clock which is synchronized. Okay. So basically we can assume that this odd and even input streams were generated from this clock. How it was generated, whatever. It's generated from the digital circuit and this was the clock used to generate it. So the rising edge of this clock happens to be in the middle of these bits and the falling edge is synchronized to the transitions of the bits. Okay. So this is what we have. Now how do we do this? So we don't have a clock at twice the rate. Sample at both edges. Okay. So what do we actually do? What blocks do we need to implement this? MUX and a flip flop. Okay. So first thing is, let's try this. We have a MUX. If the control is 0, the upper input goes to the output, and if the control is 1, the lower input goes to the output. So what do I put here at the inputs? The input streams. So let's say the even stream goes here and the odd stream goes here. And what do I put here? Clock. So this should work in that when the clock is 0 in this region, so in this region it's supposed to select this part. The output will follow this, and in this region, the output will follow this one. Okay. Does it work? So it seems to work. Basically, we have a clock which is negative for half the duration of this bit period, half the duration of this bit, and positive for half the duration of this bit. So when it is negative, when it is 0, it follows the, it lets the even stream go out. When it is 1, it lets the odd stream go out. Okay. So that gives us the basic multiplexing action, and it looks like we will get this as the output, right? What is the potential problem with this, or are there any? Is there a problem with something like this? Towards the falling edge of the clock, there is a possibility of glitch, because you see, this is synchronized with this, but I mean, nothing is exactly synchronized, right? So there can be some delays between this clock and this data, and the falling may not be exact, and also the rise times are not 0, right? Rise times and fall times of any signal is not 0. So what you may end up getting, let's take a somewhat crude case where the clock is delayed with respect to the ideal position. So what happens now? In this part, you will get 1, right? Bit number 1. And in this part, you will get bit 2. Is that correct? Sorry, you get bit 3. Yeah, you get bit 3, and then after that you get bit 2. Firstly, the output is not periodic with CS by 2. I mean, output is, the bit duration is not TS by 2, and you have a glitch, right? You have an incorrect output. Is this clear how this error comes about? Simply because of the skewed timing of the clock. Is that possible? So the question is, does it matter if the time, the period of this bit is not exactly TS by 2, but the sequence is exactly the same. Is that possible? Firstly, is it okay to have that? So let me say that it will be okay, right? Let's assume that it will be okay if you have the same sequence of bits, but the rate is different. But is it possible to have something like that? I mean, if it's possible, how is it possible? If it's not possible, why is it not possible? See, in a certain number, in a certain amount of time, you have a certain number of input bits. So, if the output rate is not exactly TS by 2, you either lose bits or you don't have anything to transmit, right? If the output rate, let's say the period is smaller than TS by 2, then let's say in 4 times TS, you have only 8 symbols coming in. Whereas in 4 times TS, you may have to transmit 9 symbols in this case. So, where is the 9th symbol? You don't have that information. Similarly, if the period is longer, you have to lose some bits. Simply because in a certain amount of time, you get so many bits in and you can only push so many bits out. So, that's not possible. Okay, so we have this problem with the glitch because of the skew. How do we get rid of it? How do we make it robust? Edge triggered. What is edge triggered here? The output of which one? So, I will put a flip-flop here. Okay, how do you do that? That is possible, except that, let's see actually if that is possible. Firstly, you're saying that we'll generate a clock at twice the rate. We don't know how to do that, but let's say we can somehow manage that one. So, what do you have? Something like this, okay? So, and then what do we do now? Only at the positive edge of which clock? See, in the double clock, you have two edges in every bit period. So, which one should it sample? Yeah, actually this is not easy thing to do because you are sampling twice inside this. Which one is the valid data? Which one do you want to take? It's not clear, right? And also when you generate a doubled one, there is no saying exactly how the timing of this relates to the timing of this. There may be skews there also. Yeah, so that was what was suggested earlier also. So, the problem is, at this point, the data is changing and the clock is changing. If you are passing the data in this phase, you have a problem. Actually, you have a problem even if you are passing the data in this phase, right? Because if the clock happens to be advanced, then you will get a glitch in the other direction. So, the first thing is to shift the data by half a clock cycle. How do we do that? Which one do you want to shift? So, let's say I still have even going to 0 and odd going to 1. And this is the output. I don't mean that it is directly going to this. You may have some circuitry in between if you want. But even input corresponds to input 0 of the marks. So, what do I shift and where? The odd data should be shifted. So, let's see what happens if we do that. Okay. So, this is a D flip flop. And what is the clock of the D flip flop? How do I clock the D flip flop so that there is no problem? Positive edge of this clock. Okay. So, this is not very visible, but so this works. So, is this okay? Or can there be a problem? Problem with the rising edge. So, is there a problem with the rising edge? If so, what's the problem? No, that is what you wanted, right? We wanted to delay it by half a clock cycle. No, this idea of synchronizing at the input is correct. What I am asking is this specific arrangement problem free? Will it give you reliably the output that you want or is there a problem? There is a delay for the odd. That's okay, right? You effectively have a delay for the odd one. That is what you want, right? Because you get one after the other. So, you get one after 0, whereas here 0 and 1 are coming together. So, one is delayed by half a clock cycle more than the other. Should I have a flip-flop for even also? Okay, what is that? So, let's say I have a flip-flop and what is the clock for that one? Clock bar. So, basically I will say this is a negative edge-triggered flop and connect it here. So, the question is this correct? Is this what you want to do? Delay through the D flip-flop may not be the? Actually, that is what happens. So, let's say we have a D flip-flop and there is a clock. So, Q should change in response to D at the rising edge of the clock. Okay? So, this is the clock and the value of Q should change ideally at this point. But in reality, what happens is, you will have some delay of the flip-flop. That is known as the clock to Q delay. I think you are familiar with this. So, this is what you get. So, given this, does this arrangement work? After even, you have the previous Q value. So, what do you have to do? Now, is the problem clear to everyone? See, this is changing at the negative edge of the clock, the output here. Okay? But it won't change exactly at the instant of the negative edge. It will change a little bit after that. And you are trying to pass this to the output when the clock becomes negative. I mean, when the clock becomes 0. So, actually what you have to do is, because of this delay, the data changes a little bit after the edge. So, this particular data has to be routed not in this phase of the clock, but in the next phase. the one going to the zero input of the mux should be triggered during the positive edge. So little bit after the positive edge, this data is stable. Now when the clock becomes zero, this data is let out. Okay? So when the clock is zero, this data is constant and stable. That's what you want. Okay? Similarly here, the data at this point changes a little bit after the negative edge. So you let it out when the clock is positive. That is when the clock is one. So if you look at, let me call this even prime and odd prime. If you look at even prime and odd prime on the clock, they look like this. Let's say this is the clock. So even prime looks like, so this is the clock to Q delay. And odd also has a delay with respect to the negative edge. So you, during the negative phase of the clock, when the clock is zero, this part is stable, so you let the even stream out. And during the positive part of the clock, this is stable, so you let the odd stream out. So just because of the delay through the flip-flop, you have to do this. And this, actually the delay helps you here because it stabilizes the data by that time. So if there was exactly no delay, then you couldn't figure out what is happening. Because there is delay, you are sure that when the clock is zero, this part is stable. Right? The even data is stable. So you need some synchronization in the beginning and you multiplex it like this. Is the operation of this clear? Even stream and odd stream. So we have even stream and odd stream are both changing together with the clock. Synchronized meaning there also there will be a delay, right? So all these are, let's say these are the outputs of some circuit. Okay. So this clock is what generates the even and the odd stream. So if we assume that, we don't know how even and odd were generated. We'll assume that even and odd were generated from a state machine or some digital circuit which uses this clock. Okay, the same clock has to be used. If you have a totally different clock, then you may have a problem. So if you somehow get a clock that is synchronized or approximately synchronized, then if you do this, you will be fine. Okay. Even and odd are changing together, yeah. So that's what happens, right? So when you have a parallel data bus, all the bits will change at a given instant. It's not like they'll change it. I mean, there may be random skews, mismatch, but they're all synchronized with respect to some clock. So now you use that to get a higher speed output. So if I have four streams, what do I do? Let's say I have, I'll just call it stream 0, 1, 2, 3. And what I want at the output is first from stream 0, 1, 2, 3, and then 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. Right? The first bit should come from here, the next one from here, the next one from here, and so on. So the whole thing should repeat. How do I do this? I mean, let's first try and do it with something that we already know. We know how to do 2 to 1. How do we do this one? Let's say we somehow get the controls, but can we do it with 2 to 1 muxes? We have to use 3 of them, right? So let's say the idea is you first put 2 of these together and then put 2 more of those together. What are the inputs to this? What are the inputs to this one? 0 and 2, right? Because you want 0, 1, 2, 3. Otherwise, if you put 0 and 1, at the output here, you get 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1. And here you get 2, 3, 2, 3 and so on. So what you get at the output is 0, 2, 1, 3. It will be in the wrong order, that's all. I mean, this is some simple logical stuff. There is nothing complicated here. So this is what you do. And of course, you need synchronization. So we'll have flip-flops here and triggered at the appropriate edge. So we won't go into how we did it. So the controls for all of these flip-flops are the clock, is the input clock, and also control for the first stage of the multiplexing is the input clock. What about the second stage? It has to be at twice the rate. So what do we do? Divide by 2. You get divide by 2 to get twice the frequency. Actually you use divide by 2, and typically the way it is done is you start with the high frequency stuff, you divide it by 2 and generate this. This is typically how systems are constructed. You don't make frequency multipliers. You start with the highest frequency that you want and you can divide by 2. That's the easy thing to do. It's assumed that you need the high frequency somewhere. So you have to generate the high frequency somehow, but you do it only once. So that needs a frequency multiplier. We won't discuss now how to multiply up frequencies. But then after that, any submultiple of that you generate by dividing. Okay. So we assume that we have the high frequency clock and we divide it by 2 to get this, and this goes here. It also goes to the synchronizing flip-flops in front of the second stage. Okay. This diagram is a bit messy, but I think you get the idea. So after this, it's just a matter of bookkeeping, right? You can do 8 to 1 or 16 to 1. If you have any power of 2 to 1, it's quite easy to do. So there are other architectures also, like someone suggested using a counter and a 4 to 1 mux. So that's also possible, but this tree structure is an easy modular thing. Okay. And once you understand this, understanding the other ones also is not very difficult. So we are just going to discuss this and we'll implement this in one of the assignments or something. It's the data that is generated with respect to the clock, right? So the clock is the driving force for let's say a state machine. So everything is a state machine, right? It's a state machine and some combination logic. So all the data is synchronized to some clock that you provide to the system. That's the assumption. We are assuming some synchronous system here, which consists of state machines and whatever, and it gets this clock as the input and it generates the data. Yeah. No. In this case, we assume that this is given. Okay. So let's talk about clock recovery afterwards. If you are given data without the clock which generated it, we have to somehow get back the clock. So that we will deal with afterwards. So is this clear? Any questions on this? So far we have not discussed any non-ideality except this delay, and I think also you are familiar with how to implement D flip-flops and so on. So this is about as far as we go while discussing serializers. Let's say we want to do the opposite. We have a high frequency data stream and we want to go down to lower frequencies. What do we do? So let's say I have an input stream, and from this I want to generate two outputs. So this, if you look at any given instant, there will be two outputs and they should be before this. You can pass the same data to two flip-flops. Okay, let's again assume that accompanying this we have a clock which generated this data. Just for consistency, we'll assume rising edge to be in the middle of the. So what do we do? So these are the signals we have to take and generate these two. And of course, we should generate a clock so that the following stage can use this. Again, we may not have just one stage of this. We may want to go from this to like four different streams. So let's say that we want to generate these two and also the clock, which has a similar timing as this. Right, with the rising edges in the middle of data. No, that is the multiplexer. You have multiple inputs and get the. Okay, so let's try something like that. So I'm not sure what you meant by a demultiplexer, right? Because a combinational demultiplexer is something very different. It is like a one-off and decoder type of thing. So you can imagine using that also with some appropriately complicated control signal, but we'll not do that. So we are just interested in 1 to 2. So first we divide this clock by 2. Okay. So, how do we make a clock divider? How do we divide the clock by 2? A D flip flop with a Q bar connected to D. Should this be a rising edge or a falling edge? Should this flip flop be triggered on the rising edge or the falling edge? How do you decide that? Or it doesn't matter. I mean, it could be that it doesn't matter. I don't know. Input data is changing at the falling edge. So, where should you clock it? You clock it at the rising edge, right? You want to clock it where? See, how do you decide where to clock? You can even clock it at the falling edge. In many systems you do that, but we'll assume that if you clock it here, then that gives you the biggest margin for skew, right? If this goes back or forth by some amount, it gives you the biggest margin. So we'll clock it in the middle of the data bit. This is what we'll assume for now. Later we'll see whether to clock it on the, when you design traditional digital circuits, it will end up being clocked at the end of the clock phase, okay? But that leaves very little margin. So let's say you move this data by some amount, it goes to either the previous bit or this bit. Whereas if you clock it in the middle, you have the biggest margin. Even if the data transition moves back or forth by some amount, you will still sample the same. So, as far as margin for error is concerned, you should sample at the middle of the. So, that means that this is clocked by the rising edge. And the output waveform that comes out is, so this is clock, and call it clock 2. This is clock 2. Now, what do I do with this? So I have these signals, the data, clock and clock 2, and I want these. Okay. So this data goes to a D flip flop, let's say, and the clock is clock 2, is it? What is the clock to this flip flop? Clock 2. So is this a rising edge or a falling edge flip flop? You need both. Okay. The same data goes to the 2. So is this all? Is this complete? What do the outputs look like now? So they are skewed from each other by half a clock cycle. Right. So, for instance, the E1 stream 0, 2, they come out here, comes out here. Okay. So, the E1 stream is changing at these points and the hot stream is changing at these points. So, I don't want that. I want the output to look something like this, where the E1 and hot streams are changing at the same time. So, what do I do now? I have to delay the E1. Why? How do I do that? Hot stream synchronized to? It says synchronized to the falling edge of the clock. So, what do we have to do? Okay. Why not put a flip-flop after the odd one with a positive edge trigger? Yeah, actually it will be further delayed. So, We have a picture like this. So this has to get delayed by half a clock cycle. Okay, to get this picture. Clock 2, this is the divided clock. And I have two flip-flops. And I have this even and odd strings. And this has to be further delayed. I mean, it has to be synchronized to the negative edge. So that these two outputs are changing at the same time. Those two outputs change at the same time. Okay. So then the two outputs will correspond to this. So now both the outputs will change at the falling edge. The outputs are taken from flip-flops, which is negative edge triggered. Okay. So both this and this change at the falling edge of clock 2. So they are synchronized. So basically we know how to deserialize also. Is there some simplification that's possible in this? Do we need 3 flip-flops? How do you make a flip-flop? Using latches. Okay, so we'll have 2 latches, right? So to make a positive edge triggered flip-flop, we'll have a negative level latch followed by a positive level latch. So the one without the edge symbol is just a latch. So given that this is how you make a flip-flop, is some simplification possible in this one? If you look at it, that's correct. This is realized by having a negative level latch followed by a positive level latch. And this is realized using a positive level latch followed by a... So you have 2 latches one after the other doing the same thing, right? So it's really transparent from here to here. Is this clear? The first latch of this, the second latch of this is a positive level latch. The first latch of this is a positive level latch. So between the output of the master of this and the input of the slave of the second one, you have a transparent latch. Really, if you have 2 latches, it's still transparent, right? Is this clear or not? So these 2 latches can be replaced by a single latch. So the final system looks like this. These are just latches, not flip-flops. This is the input data. This is the input clock. You have to divide this by 2, okay? And you divide it on the positive edge of this. This is assuming that the input data, the positive edge of the clock is at the middle of input data, okay? If this is the master-slave, master structure, I mean basically the polarity of the first one is the same as the third one, and this is master-slave, even and odd stream out. Which of these corresponds to the bits that came earlier in time and which one corresponds to the later one? If you want to put it back together, would you put even first or odd first? No, I mean even if you put it the other way, you will get alternating, right? Yeah. So this, if you look at it, this has gone through more delay. The two output streams change at the same instant, right? That's how we arranged it. They change at the negative edge of the clock. Okay? Negative edge of clock 2 rather. But they arrive at the same instant, but this goes through more delay. This path. This has 3 latches, this has 2 latches. So that means whatever came here, came first and in, right? It goes through more delay, so that corresponds to an earlier time. So this one corresponds to an earlier time. Whatever is on the 3 latch branch corresponds to the earlier time. Whatever is on the 2 latch branch corresponds to the later time. So again, this is all at a simple logic level so far. And this is used so routinely that I thought we'll finish it off first. Because we are talking about transmitting data at high frequencies and so on. So the first day I outlined the trade-offs. So you can, if you want to transmit a certain number of bits in a certain number of seconds, you can either do it as a number of parallel streams at a low rate or a single stream at a high rate. There is some trade-off there. So whenever you have that kind of thing, this type of blocks are used routinely because you have to combine the streams and then split them and so on. So what is the correct speed for something may not be correct speed for something else. Okay? Maybe for transmission, because you have a single cable, you combine it to the highest speed that's possible and send it out. But that is not the speed that is appropriate for doing signal processing. Because you want complicated signal processing functions, you may want to do it at a, you have to do it at a lower speed, otherwise the circuits don't work. So for that you have to split it back. So in that case you use a deserializer. Okay? And that's typically how things look like. So you have a high speed link and you have a deserializer on this side. And deserializer means it has a block like this. It may have something else before that so that the signal is received properly and so on. As I mentioned earlier, if you pass data through a long transmission line, you can't distinguish between ones and zeros. So that part we have not dealt with. If the signal at this end, let's say, has a very poor signal to noise or very poor noise margin, how do you distinguish between ones and zeros? That we have not looked at. Let's assume that ones and zeros can be distinguished here, but this is at a high speed and you want a low speed data here for signal processing. Then you put a deserializer. Similarly, you generated the signal using some signal processing, but you generate it in a parallel format, because the DSP only works at a low speed. So you make any signal processing can be done in parallel also, right? So you can do it at a low speed, but do it in parallel. Then you serialize it, and these two together are known as SerDes, okay? Serializer, deserializer. Like most of these chips that are used for communications over PCBs and so on are known as SerDes chips, and they can be more or less sophisticated. Maybe they have, all they have is something like this, right? They have a deserializer with digital latches and a serializer with digital latches and digital muxes and so on. But as you go to higher and higher frequencies, you come to a situation where after you transmit the data over a wire, you can no longer distinguish the ones and zeros properly. So that part we'll deal with when we discuss equalization. Okay, is this clear? How to make serializer or deserializer? It's a pretty simple logic. So one last thing: how do I do a deserialization to 4? I have a single stream, and I want to get the first bit should go to 1, next to 2, next to 3, next to 4. How do I do this? Is the question clear? I just want to split the single stream into 4 streams. That's all. We just discussed how to do one stream into 2 streams. How do I do this? Yeah, that also may be possible. Meaning, in a single shot, you can try to do all of them. That is, you have maybe five flip flops in this, 4 in this, 3 in this, and 2 in this, or something. But again, we prefer a tree modular structure. Okay, so you pass it through a deserializer, and you get 2 of them. So let's say the bit sequence here is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Here I get 0, 2, 4, 6, and here I get 1, 3, 5, 7. Okay, and simply I put it through 2 more blocks. Okay, each one is a 1 to 2 deserializer. So here I get 0, 4, 8 and so on. So I get 2, 6, 10, 5, 9, and 3, 7, 11 and so on. So all I have to do is just bookkeeping to see which order I have to put it back together, right? So it is 0, 1, 2, 3. So that's the order. But that's a trivial thing. I have 4 wires. It doesn't matter which order I put it back in. So that's how I have to interpret the data, that's all. So again, it is possible to do 1 to 4 also in a single step, but we'll just discuss the tree structure. So this is modular. Actually, what comes out is not just the data. We can think of the clock divider also as part of this. So each deserializer generates, it takes the input stream and the clock corresponding to the input stream. It generates 2 output streams and a clock corresponding to each of the output streams. So this clock will drive the following deserializers, right? And each one will give a clock. Now this clock is at 1/4 the rate of this one. So if this is fs, this is fs by 2, this is fs by 4. So each deserializer takes and gives out data 0, data 1 and clock. See, there is nothing that says that you have to only do 2 in one step. We can also have 3 to 1 multiplexer and so on. Similarly 1 to 3 demultiplexer, etc. So this is the easiest, so this is most commonly used. And if you have a freedom over the data rates inside, let's say you are choosing what rate to transmit the data at or what rate to do the signal processing. In that case, you can always use this, right? You have freedom to do that. So let's say you are transmitting at 10 gigabits per second, but you can only do signal processing at 100 megabits per second. That's the highest frequency that you can do. So then you have to demultiplex by a factor of 100. Now 100 is not a power of 2, so you go to 128, which goes to 78 megabits per second. So if you can do 100, you can definitely do 78. And if you have, if there is nothing constraining you to exactly 100, you do this. Because to make a multiplexing by a different factor is complicated. So one idea that you can do, one idea that you can use is you always demultiplex by a factor of, a factor which is a power of 2. And then you can rotate the data, right? So you can have blocks. Let's say there are 4 inputs and 5 outputs. So during the first interval, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 2, 3 come here. During the next one, 0, 1, 2, 3 appear here. So you can make a rotator. It's like a barrel shifter or something. So with this, you can realize all this with a tree structure which gives you a power of 2. And you can rotate it so that this will give you now 4 to 5. Right? So let's say you want demultiplexing by 33. You first do by 32. And then you put it through a 32 to 33 rotator.